Hello and welcome to the Preparing, Archiving, and Accessing NIJ Data Seminar. We're glad that you could join us today. My name is Julia Roach and I'm the Archive Manager at the National Archive of Criminal Justice Data. Co-presenting with me today from the National Institute of Justice are Patrick Clark, the Data Resources Program Manager, and Cheryl Crawford Watson, the Human Subjects Protection Officer. You will be hearing from each of them momentarily. Today, we would like to share information with you about human subjects and confidentiality, describe the NIJ archiving requirements, give you a brief introduction to ICPSR and the archive, and describe the data archiving lifecycle. Then we will shift gears a bit and go over some of the logistics with depositing data for archiving, and lastly, go over a demonstration of how to use the NACJD website. It is our hope that this information will be helpful to you as you prepare your data for archiving, no matter at what stage you are in your project's lifecycle. Now I will turn things over to Cheryl Crawford Watson, who will describe the human subjects and confidentiality aspects in more detail.
Thank you. On this slide, you will see the laws and regulations that are related to Department of Justice funded research, and that applies to all of the agencies within the Office of Justice programs, including the National Institute of Justice. You will see that the first two citations are for our confidentiality statute and regulations, which we'll be talking a little bit more about in the coming slides. The third citation is for the Department of Justice's common rule. We are a common rule agency, although by policy we do follow the subparts on children, prisoners, and pregnant women. Next slide, please. Confidentiality basics, just some generalities for you to be aware of. All of the identifiable data that's collected with Department of Justice research funds can only be used for research and no other purpose without the subject consent. The subject is welcome to give out their identifiable data to anyone they want to, but if we collect it, if DOJ funded researchers collect it, it can only be used for research and statistical purposes, and it can't be released for any purpose without the subject consent. The identifiable data must be kept confidential, and there are just a list of what identifiable data is that you're always familiar with: IP addresses, social security numbers, fingerprints, voice prints, etc., and biometric identifiers. The consent process is critical. It is a process. It's not simply giving them a consent form and having them sign it. There is a process to it of notification and the types of things that must be included, which we will talk about as well. The types of data that are archived, of course, the quantitative data and the qualitative data. Some of the qualitative data would not necessarily need to be archived, but again, if you are going to archive it, and Julie will be going through some of that with you later, if you're going to archive it, of course, consent needs to be obtained for that. Next slide, please. This citation is one that's important for you to keep in mind and to note, 42 U.S.C. 3789G. It is our confidentiality statute, and it provides the information that all the identifiable data collected is immune from legal process. Of course, anyone can subpoena anyone, so any DOJ-funded researcher can get a subpoena, but they may not release any identifiable data to that subpoena request. Next slide, please. Under the Department of Justice confidentiality regulations, there is the requirement for a privacy certificate. A privacy certificate is different from a certificate of confidentiality, which you as researchers may know about or may have obtained for HHS research or NIH, any clinical or medical type of research. A privacy certificate is different, and it's important to understand those differences. A privacy certificate will describe the research. It is submitted by the principal investigator, who will describe the research, who will assure that they will comply with the requirements, who will in detail describe the procedures that will be used to collect that data, to maintain the data, and you can see there it will include the data archiving plan and any data sharing or information transfer agreements. If, for example, two researchers are working together and they're working out of different universities, they would have an information transfer agreement. Next slide, please. This is the slide. As I said, it's a process. There's a process of informing and then obtaining the consent. Subjects should be told and understand that their participation is voluntary, that they can stop participating at any time, what the study risks are, what the benefits are, whether or not any compensation may accrue to them for participating in the interview or the survey, whether if they are getting compensation for that, whether or not they will still get the full compensation if they quit after question two rather than filling out all 100 questions. Another important part of the information they should be given is how their data will be maintained. Is the researcher collecting it on laptops? Is it on secure thumb drives after it's downloaded to a computer? How that data security will be maintained. Another important piece of information is how long the researcher will keep it. Will they keep it forever? Will they keep it for 7 years, 3 years? Will it be kept and used in a longitudinal study? Those types of things are important for a subject to know, particularly the length of time it will be maintained and how long it will be held by the researcher or the research assistants or whomever may be assisting with the data collection. It's important for the subjects to know whether or not they may be recontacted. If you are funded for a longitudinal study, it's important for them to understand whether they will be followed up every 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, or whether they may be subject to follow-up in the coming years. You may not have funding now for a longitudinal survey, but the pilot you're doing now you may want to build on. So in the consent form for your current study, it would be wise to include whether or not there's a potential for follow-up or no follow-up. It's important for the subject to know who's funding the study, who is conducting the study. We, even though it's not spelled out specifically in the DOJ regulations, we expect the researcher to tell the subject who is funding the study. So after that process has gone through, whether it's verbal consent, oral consent, whether it's written consent, they need to get all of this information, and then the subject would give their consent to participate, and if it's applicable, would give their consent for reporting. There are some states that have mandatory, many states that have mandatory child abuse and elder abuse reporting laws. The Department of Justice confidentiality statute takes precedent over those. As we have said before, the identifiable data can only be used for research and no other purpose, so the subject consent is needed in order for a DOJ-funded researcher to make a child abuse or elder abuse report.
The NIJ Office of Research and Evaluation puts a special grant condition on most awards regarding the data and associated artifacts that are due 90 days prior to the end of a grant award. The data archiving plan is the first part of that special condition, and this has been a requirement of NIJ grant applications for probably the last 5 or 6 years. I'll discuss the details of the archiving plan in a minute, But the new part of this is the data submission checklist. The data submission checklist and data other associated documents are also to be submitted 90 days ahead of time. Julia will go into detail about the data submission checklist in a little bit. And I would reiterate, the data must be de-identified prior to submission unless archiving of information identifiable to a private person is provided for in the informed consent process as approved by the IRB and the NIJ Human Subjects Protection Officer. The data archiving plan was designed primarily to give the grantee an appreciation of the archiving process, but also to build in the cost associated with that process as they budget for the research grant. It is to be a brief document, including a description of formats of data, the software that is used in data collection and analysis, the procedures by which data will be collected, and if the proposed research includes information identifiable to a private person, the assurances of confidentiality, the consent form that was approved by the IRB and the Human Subjects Protection Officer, a copy of the privacy certificate, and the IRB approval documentation. It also includes a description of processes used to de-identify the data, any information transfer agreements that were utilized, any anticipated variable creation, data transformations, scale construction, etc., and a plan for submission of the computer programming code or software syntax that was used to analyze the data, the technical documentation in the way of the code book, and then also contact information for the principal investigator. This short document is submitted at the time of the application, but also can be revised and updated at the time you're ready to archive your data. This is the funding page from the NIJ website. On the left-hand side under funding is a hyperlink to more detail about human subjects and privacy protection, and also a hyperlink to detail about the data resources program, including the data archiving plan and the data submission checklist. Here is contact information for myself and Sherry Crawford Watson. Please feel free to contact us now or in the future with any questions you might have. I know Julia has set aside time at the end of this webinar for questions, and we'll both stick around to address them as they're presented. Thank you very much.